probably in the kitchen. Smells pretty good from here even. Burn a little plastic. I think that happened on a few Wednesdays ago. We're glad that you're here this morning. We do have our church Thanksgiving lunch after our service today. So someone asked me if I was going to preach fast, and I just laughed at them. I didn't say a word, so I think they know what that meant. All right, let's all stand together. Start with the word prayer. Lord, we thank you that we can be here this morning just to sing praises to you. Lord, I pray that we would just focus on you, Lord. Lord, that we would lay our problems down at your feet. We thank you for how you bless us so much. I pray today, Lord, that we allow your spirit to move in this place in a mighty way. Lord, for those that are listening online, I pray that too, Lord, that those worship with us and allow your word to sink deep into our hearts. Lord, we just love you for all you do.
Oh, today. We thank you for a special day that we come together and just praise your name, lift up the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray that we just do what you'd have us to do, not what the world does, Lord. Lord, we thank you for each one that's here. We just ask you to bless them. Lord, be with the dinner fellowship, Lord, with the other churches, Lord. We pray that we'll have a good time together in your name. Lord, we just come at this time to give a little back to you, Lord, and just ask you to bless the offering that comes in. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
And let's continue to worship as you bring the tithes out. Thank you. Lord, all of our hope is in you. Our hope is not in the things of this world or other people, but in you. Lord, I pray this morning that we'll listen to you, to your word, and that, Lord, we'll apply it in our lives and allow you to guide us, to be in charge. Lord, we just thank you that we can come here each week and worship you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we've been going through our series, we continue this morning. And I just want to tell you this title. I know we had a title similar to it. And as you look in every one of Paul's letters, you're going to find a sermon that says something like this, that says, get along. One of the concerns that Paul had for the church was that the people were not getting along with one another. If you think about it, churches today, there's a lot of churches that people don't want to go to because they simply cannot get along. Some of you may have siblings that are that way.
Amen.
Amen. I didn't. I'll make sure that your siblings know.
Paul is his spouses.
And spouses, amen. Oh, see, no one said amen there. And so, there are times that it is tough for us to get along with other people. But understand that it affects the church, it affects Christians as a whole, and we can't get along. Who has ever here put the curse on your kid? You know, the curse that says, I hope your children are 10 times worse than you are. Amen? We've all did that to our kids. We have put that curse on them. And I want to tell you, it works. Amen. It works. You know, I've also found that it works for other areas. I took swimming for a long time. And some of my swimmers, at least one of them in the building today, some of my swimmers would get a little mouthy and wouldn't do what I would tell them, or they would try to sneak out of sets or something that we were doing, and I would say, one of these days when you coach, I hope your kids act just as bad as y'all are acting. And they always go, I will never coach. The best ones I ever coached are coaching as we speak. And as Theron called me yesterday and said, Dad, would you please stop the curse of my swimmers because they're acting just like I used to. And my answer was simple. No, why would I stop that? Why would I stop that? It's awesome to watch. I'm glad Mom walked in because when the kids were little, and of course, they fight, amen? Kids fight all the time. The kids were little, and they would be fighting. And my mom would just be sitting like it was ringside at a boxing match with a big grin on her face. I go, Mom, how could you be smiling about something like this? And she says, payback. For all the times you and your brother fist fought and misbehaved and got into it, this is payback. It kind of is, isn't it? When I watch swimmers back top there, it shouldn't make me happy, but it does. Allie, she is just, I think, about 6 months old. She's not for real. And she's already given Tyler grief. And every time he tells me about it, I just laugh and say, amen. Amen. But you know, while Mom would laugh, because it is funny to a point, my mom would also tell you, and I would tell you the same, that if you're not careful, that if you fight all the time, then you'll keep doing that as you become an adult. And I will tell you, I'm sure my kids still have words at times, but I want them to get along. You know, my brother and I had a time frame there in our lives. We didn't get along. We didn't speak to each other very often. And it was really tough because we both had to give on some things. Because I knew my brother was wrong and he knew I was wrong. And it took just a little time. You know, God can take terrible things and make good things from them. My mom would tell you that if any one good thing happened when her mother had Alzheimer's and she had to watch that, if one good thing happened, it was that her and my Uncle Roger became friends again. They would argue so much that my grandmother kicked them out of the hospital. My grandfather was in the hospital. I mean, they would just get into it all the time. But because of what they experienced with my grandmother, they had to rely on each other. And they became friends. And now, they talk all the time. All the time. My uncle's really concerned about COVID still. He's really worried about it. And so, he really doesn't talk to anybody except my mom. I'm so glad they have that relationship. And I'm so glad my Roger has someone that is there to listen to him. He's not married. You just think he was a hermit. He's always been a hermit. But with COVID, it's times 10. Unfortunately, I've seen this happen with our Christian brothers and sisters as well. They just fight, fight, fight to the point that they hate each other. I think about all the time many people that have been in Bel Air that have left or have passed away, and I think about them, and I think sometimes people think I think bad things about them, but I don't. I think about how God blessed me to be a pastor for them and with them. I think about how I miss them, and people go, really, you miss those people? Yeah, I did. You know, as you mature, you learn to take things differently, don't you?
Amen.
You do. Things that used to really bother me and upset me are not a big deal. I look back now and go, ah, man, I wish I wouldn't have thought about that. What a silly little thing. But I did anyhow. I've often wondered if those people would be willing to come back. You know what it would take for them to do that? Humbleness on their part, humbleness on mine. But if they're not going to church because they battle me, that's a loss for Christians and for the church as a whole. And I would encourage those people, get back to church. Find a family. You know, some of our new families aren't here this morning, and I pray for them every day. Been so happy to have new people come in. It's been good. It's been fun to watch the little ones run around. You know, Darren and I was talking about today how much Junior has matured. Not just in height. I mean, man, he's a tall kid. I think Junior used to make me more crazy than Ava makes me crazy. That's kind of hard to do. But it's so fun to watch them mature, isn't it? Watch them grow up. I'm hoping to get to hear Tyler play at the end of December or in January when you're here. When he plays drums, I just sit there and smile. I mean, I have no criticism, and he's just grown. He's already ready to teach Ali Joe how to play the drums. I don't know if Rose is happy about that, but he's ready to teach him. I remember when Ray would have to get after Tyler. Tyler's a little taller than Ray. Just a little. And I could tell that Tyler didn't like it, but as he got older, he knew that Ray was talking about something that he knew about. And so the next time he'd come in, he'd say, "Ray, look, I've been practicing on this thing." And he'd play it, and Ray said, "Now that's good, but now this time do it this way or this way." And that's how you train Tyler, Junior, Caitlin, Ryan, Ava, Tyson, and Trainer. We don't always get along up here. You gotta, if you wanted to hang out on a Wednesday night, every once in a while, a little fiery in here. You know, when Karen doesn't realize that I'm right and she's wrong. It's a little going in here sometimes on Wednesdays. There's been a few rehearsals that I said, "Never mind, I'm going home." And Ray would just be laughing. It's not all roses in here. But we learn how to deal with those things. That's where we are in our study this morning, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And I'm going to address the problem that Paul was addressing. But you know, I've been bragging on Bel Air a lot. And I do brag on Bel Air a lot because we're a church that is welcoming to anybody that comes in the doors. And that's how we should be. That's how all churches should be. But I think sometimes you hear these sermons, you go, "I said that last week, it doesn't really apply to me." So this morning, I want you to think about not how to get along with other church people, but how to get people to come back. You can ask Damon DeLimit, he's been here a long time. Can you imagine if we had 10% of the people that have left Bel Air come back? We couldn't fit them in this room. It wouldn't fit. Just 10%. That's a small percentage. Some people say, "Well, it'll never happen." Really? We got this thing called Facebook. Yeah, I know there's a lot of bad things on that thing called Facebook. But I see people on Facebook that maybe don't hate me as much as they used to. Maybe if I message them, maybe I already did it, and I message them, that I can begin to repair a broken relationship. Does that mean they'll come back? I have no idea. Even if they don't, that relationship needs to be repaired, doesn't it? As a Christian, if I walk around with all this hatred and bitterness in my heart, I will never be able to serve God as He's called me to do. In chapter 6, verse 1, it says, "If any of you have a dispute with another, do you dare take it before the ungodly for judgment instead of before the Lord's people? Or do you not know that the Lord's people will judge the world? And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? Do you not know that we will judge angels? How much more of the things of this life?" So I'm going to ask you three questions this morning. And the first question is, why are you fighting? Now, this really depends on who you're dealing with. I know for a fact that the boys / now men in this room have had fights before. I know that because I've heard about it. I've heard about things like some of the older boys putting younger boys into the empty graves over here. Apparently it was a Bel Air tradition that I did not know about. I don't know if they ever put Junior in there or not. done, it's done, right? When it's done, it's done. I'm sure Kevin and I, because we grew up together, we went to church together, we went to school together, I'm sure we had a few moments. But I don't remember. And I don't remember why we wrestled or fought or whatever. But the women in the room, that's a different story. Not only can you remember that you fought with someone, but you remember why. And you remember what they said, right? It's true. Like it or not, it's true. I didn't make it up. It shows the difference, one of the differences between men and women. And women, we have to learn that fighting about things isn't working. My brother and I disagree on a lot of theological things. Now, it's not theological things that keeps us from going to heaven. It's nothing like that. But we disagree. And when we were younger, we would fight about it. And all of a sudden, we grew up a little bit and we realized that it was silly. And so, we have agreed that there are certain things that we just don't talk about. Because he's not going to change, I'm not going to change. Why fight about it? Doesn't change anything. We just disagree. It's okay. Doesn't mean he's not saved. Doesn't mean I'm not saved. And so, ask yourself, why are you fighting? When I look back at the things that I fought and did as a kid, they were pretty silly. But I can look back at 51 when I was in my 30s, and I did a lot of silly things even in my 30s. I bet some of you can look back and remember in your 50s that you did some silly things. It's part of growing up. When kids act like kids, it doesn't shock them. If Junior acted like he did when he came here at like age 6, I think he was, if Junior acted like that now, four. If Junior was acting like a four-year-old now, we'd have a problem. Because he's not four. He's 13. So, ask yourself, why am I fighting? Now think about this. That verse says that we are going to judge who?
Angels.
She judged angels. Wow. That's a pretty serious job to be given. It also says that we're going to judge the world. If we can judge the world and we can judge angels, then why can't we work things out ourselves? Because what was happening is this church was suing each other back and forth, suing. And Paul's saying, don't bring the world into this. Grow up and take care. I think that's one of the reasons Bel Air doesn't battle all the time is we've grown up. And we realize it's not worth fighting. Instead, we need to figure out solutions. I didn't say give on things that matter. I'm talking about solutions. You don't have to change what you believe to solve a problem. I would encourage you this morning, whether you're listening on Facebook or you're in the building, I would encourage you to ask yourself, who have I been battling and how am I going to solve it? The way you solve it is you have to be humble. Say those three words that you don't like to say. I am sorry. Now, I'm not telling you to take blame for something you didn't do. But I've learned that every fight has at least two people. And you can base it on a percentage, but both of those people are part of that fight. It takes two, right? It takes two. And it may go, well, but I was only 10% and they were 90. It doesn't matter. It takes two. Verse 4. Therefore, if you have disputes about such matters, do you ask for a ruling from those whose way of life is sworn in the church? I say this to shame you. It is possible that there is nobody among you wise enough to judge a dispute between believers. But instead, one brother takes another to court, and this in front of unbelievers. The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means you have been completely defeated already. Why not rather be wrong? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong. You do this to your brothers and sisters. The second question is, why do you refuse to fix it? Sometimes you just need to agree to disagree, right? When I go into the schools, regardless of elementary, middle school, or high school, I find that kids are always arguing with one another. You know, the TikTok challenge, they actually have one for every month for schools. And the TikTok challenge for September was destroy and steal something from a school restroom. This cost us taxpayers about $25,000. October was slap a teacher. That did not happen in Hobbs, praise God. November is kiss your best friend's girlfriend. I know they're starting already because what happens? My friend kisses my girlfriend, there's going to be a fight. That's what happens. That's how I know that it's happening. I can't even tell you what December is. I mean, I know what it is, but I'm not going to tell you because it's not nice. But you watch this, and everything they're doing is creating conflict and destruction. It's hurting you. How would you fix that? How do you fix all the kids destroying the bathrooms? We don't know, so if you have an idea, tell me. We're not, as adults, allowed into a student restroom. So I can't go in there. Island's done a pretty good job of what they've been doing, but it's tough. You know what would fix it? Kids start acting right and fix their behavior. That's what would fix it. It would fix in churches the battles that go on in some churches. It would be fixed as Christians would just fix it and allow it to be taken care of. It says it'd be better if you were cheated or wronged than for you to battle one another as Christians in front of lost people. I have found that God knows exactly who needs to be here on Sundays. Exactly. And I'll tell you, I will not change how I'm going to preach a sermon based on who's in the building. I will not. If I say something that offends somebody, well, it's in the scripture. So if God is offending you with the scripture, that means you should fix it and change whatever it is in your life. What did Jesus say? If someone slaps you, turn the other cheek. I don't like that. I like the Old Testament better, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. That's more up my alley. Jesus says, they slap you on your cheek, you turn your other cheek, you let them slap them too. Forgive 70 times 7. That's a lot of forgiveness for people who have wronged you. Verse 9. For do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? I want you to listen to this. Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. That is what some of you were, but you were washed. You were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. The third thing is, why do you forget who you are? I'm going to give you a second. And I'm going to ask Mary Beth to go to the scripture that I hope I put up there next. If I didn't, if you can go back to 1 Corinthians 6:11. I can tell when I looked up there that I didn't. This is an important verse. If you write in your Bible or take notes, I would look at this. Because the scripture says, right before it, it lists all of these different sins, didn't it? It covered a bunch of them. I'm going to read the sins to you again. You're going to leave it right there, but I'm going to read to you the sins. The sexually immoral, idolaters, adulterers, men who have sex with men, thieves, greedy, drunkards, slanderers, swindlers, none of those people inherit the kingdom of God. Let me be clear. Everyone in the room has done some of those things, right? You go, well, I haven't done that. Well, if you think lustfully in your mind, you're an adulterer. That's what Jesus said. That's not what I said. That's what Jesus said. A drunkard. Well, I'm not a drunkard. Well, if you ever drink too much alcohol, you're on the list. Slanderers. What's a slanderer? It's someone that talks and gossips and says things about people that's not really true. I know no one in here has ever done that. But that's on the list. It talks about homosexuality. We live in a culture that we're supposed to say that's okay. And it's not okay, folks. It's not okay. Thieves. Ever steal something? You go, I've never stolen something. You know, this person doesn't come to church here anymore, but told me one time that someone left their tools in the back of his truck. And they didn't ask for them back, so he kept them. I said, that's stealing. That's being a thief. No, they left them. Well, if you told them, hey, man, you left your tools, and they said, you can have them, then you're good. But did that happen? Well, no, I didn't say anything to them because they would have wanted their tools back. Exactly. That's stealing. Everyone in the room has probably stole something. You go, well, I was just a kid. It was just a candy bar. Let me tell you, it doesn't matter, does it? It doesn't clarify. It's okay in this situation. It just says. Greed. Everyone in the room has been greedy over something before. Don't know what it is for you, but we've all been greedy. Here's the point. On your own, we're all bound for hell. On your own, we are all bound for hell. That's what God says. So if all these people are not going to heaven, then why do we have hope? We have hope because we are saved. We have hope through Jesus Christ. And verse 11 tells us, it says, and that is what some of you were. Some of you were all of those things, right? I was. I'm not going to lie about it. Some of you were. sanctified, you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. I want you to see three things right here when a person is saved, what they look like. The first is they are washed clean by the blood of Jesus. Washed clean by the blood of Jesus. When I got to this point of the sermon, I went, oh man, I should have did the song set that says, what to wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I got there and went, oh, that would have been a perfect song. I remember one time I was at a youth revival, a youth service for a lot of kids. And Chris Tomlin, who is one of my favorite worship leaders, was leading worship. And he had just sang this brand new cool song that all the kids loved, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, that was written in the 1800s. And it was a time of worship, and it was an altar call, and there was literally thousands of youth and adults there. And all of a sudden, Chris Tomlin, that guy can play guitar and piano, let me tell you. He says, I'm going to ask a question in a song, and I want you to answer it in the song. And he played very softly, and he began to sing, What Can Wash Away My Sins? And at first, it wasn't very loud. Some of the kids, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. By the time we got to the end of the song, the kids were almost screaming, nothing but the blood of Jesus. They had all these high-dollar speakers that had been brought in. And Chris Tomlin put it right where it belonged. But he pulled out one of those old hymns, another hymn that half those kids did not know was a hymn. And he asked one of the most important questions, why can't I wash away my sin? The reason I can go to God in prayer, the reason that I can have the Holy Spirit of God fill my life and overflow in my life is because when God the Father sees me, he doesn't see sin. Because if he saw the sin, I couldn't have that relationship with him. But he sees the blood of his Son, and it has washed away my sin. When a person is saved, they are sanctified. That's a big church word that I don't use very often, but it's a simple church word. It means that they're set apart. They're not like the world anymore. Now let me ask you this morning. Does your life resemble the world or Jesus? I don't know if the date, if the time is up. I'd have to look and Google it. There's been a lot of discussion about our new social studies curriculum in Hobbs, in the state, not just Hobbs. And I know a lot of teachers, good Christian teachers in Hobbs, have worked really hard to keep some of those things out of the curriculum. And it's going to come down to some battles. There's probably going to be some things in those textbooks that I don't agree with and that are evil. I hope teachers don't teach those things, but knowing how things work, it will be on the state test. It'll be in places where they have to have heard. And what Christian kids are going to have to learn to do is to be separate from the world. Now, when I went to school, they were talking about evolution, weren't they? Mm-hmm. Now, they also talked about creation. Now, they almost removed that completely. But I heard about evolution. But my dad had done a good job of teaching me the truth. My dad said, let's open up the book of Genesis and let's see how this all really happened. He told me the truth right before. So when I got to school and this came up, I already knew where I stood. That means to be sanctified, to be set apart. And then Christians are justified. Another church word, but this is the simplest one of all of them. Justified, if you break that word up, just if I never sinned. Justified. That's what God sees. When he looks on you, he sees you like you have never sinned before. And when you do sin, you're supposed to confess that sin to him and he forgets it. How good is that? If I confess my sins to some of you, you will never forget it, would you? You're like, I remember that day at the Thanksgiving dinner, Brother Sean said he did this and this. That's pretty sorry. I can't believe a preacher would do that. And 10 years from now, you still remember what I told you. But when I confess it to Jesus, he doesn't even remember the next second. It's gone. It's forgotten. I pray that as Christians that have heard this morning, that you would understand that as you mature in Christ, it's not always about you. And sometimes you have to be the one to mend that relationship. I know people in the room that have literally stopped what they're doing in their life and try to fix relationships that the other person didn't want to fix. And they would say to me, I tried to fix that relationship, Pastor, like you said, but it didn't work. And my answer to them is, you went with the heart to change. And if they don't want to change, you can't control that. But you went with the heart to change. And I always tell them, when you go to them, make sure you don't have the telephone pole in your eye. Because probably what's bugging you about that person is what you do all the time. And so you have to be humble. You have to go to that person, even though you know they did a lot wrong. You can't bring that up. You have to be the one to go, hey, I made some mistakes. I'm sorry I did this and this. I'd sure like for this to be resolved. I would like us to be able to leave without bitterness in our hearts. I've been doing that lately. This guy keeps putting people in front of me that, man, I've been bitter over different times in my life. And you know, it changes people when you go to them humble. And it's humbleness. It's real humbleness because it's hard to say those words sometimes. It's hard to forget all of those hurts. You know, I went through something many years ago and a lot of my friends were against me. I haven't talked about it much. When I was at St. John Baptist pastor's anniversary with Brother B.J. Choice, they wanted me to speak about my friendship with B.J. Choice. I've never been asked to do that. Usually you're asked to read Old Testament or New Testament scripture or give a testimony or something like that. And this time I was asked as a friend to speak about Reverend Choice. Now, I think there was a lot of surprised people when a big, tall, bald-headed guy, white guy, got up there and was talking. But I said to them, and this is a true story, the first time I met him, I was at Pleasant Green Baptist Church with my friend Russell Hill. He had asked me, invited me to come and read scripture, so I showed up. And Reverend Choice says, where did this tall, skinny white boy come from? He looked at me. Are you lost? You know where you're at. I told him, all those people, they looked at me strange, but I said, my first thought was this crazy old man needs to get his act together. You know, that crazy old man became my friend. That crazy old man did our wedding. And when all these other preachers that I thought were my friends bailed out on me, I made Jay Choice. So when I got up there to talk about my friend, it was easy because he was there when I needed him. I had no idea that he had went through the same things in his ministry and his life. I had no idea. When he came and counseled Karen and I thought, man, I've been easy on people. I didn't know you're supposed to do this stuff on people when you counsel. And he sat in my chair like he was in charge or something. It's easy to go and talk about how he's my friend. There's others. Carl Mackey is a good one. He wanted to kick me out of their church when I showed up. At his funeral, where there was a lot of people. Guess who they asked to speak? Me. Why? Because I got to know him. I didn't agree with him on a lot of things, but I got to know him. I'm telling you, Bel Air, we're doing good. We're doing good. But I think it's time for us to be those people. God, help us rebuild old relationships that got broken. Sometimes you're going to go, not that person, God. I meant somebody else, not that person. Try to tell one last thing. I told him on Wednesday, I almost made it without crying, almost. But we have a big project going on in the district, and usually once the papers are signed and the project begins, you don't see the CEO ever again. The CEO showed up and came into my office, and we were talking, and telling him the project was going good, and we were talking about that, and all of a sudden, it just hit me, and I said, you know, we've had a hard time over here, because our friend Ben, I told him what had happened with his daughter being killed, and his grandchildren seeing that, one of them getting hit with a bullet. And this man, who has never met him, not one time, started crying. Well, you know, both of us were crying. He said, how old are those children? And I told him, he said, I have two children that are almost identical in age. I mean, by weeks. He said, I can't imagine. And then I told him about my friend J.W. has been in the hospital for several weeks. He was going to go into rehab this week, and he called and talked to us, and we were praising God. We were so excited. We found out on Friday he's not doing good. I told this man what we were struggling with. He kicked my door shut, and he walked over, and he said, I think we need to pray. And he started praying for people he didn't know. And he was sincere for sure. We finished, he gave me a big hug, and he said, we may be a little distance between us, but you're my brother. And I'm so happy that I got to meet you. We've been texting back and forth about things since then. I told him, no, pastors don't have any friends. I'm going to consider you as a friend. I can call or text him anytime, and he's going to drop whatever he's doing and help me. I'm so thankful for that. I have never had a vendor walk over and put their hands on me and pray. Man, I can't even tell you, I can't explain to you how that felt. And to see him hurting because someone else is hurting. That's what it means to be a Christian. We hurt when other people hurt, even when we don't really know. We rejoice when they do well. You know, Dolores got a choir concert coming up pretty soon. I'll make sure I get you the date and time. It's the honor choir. This is a special choir for all the kids in the area to make. And she made the choir. It's a big deal, especially for a seventh grade. You know, I think it'd be awesome if a bunch of you were able to come. Her choir concert, Brother Ray and I came in there. I even know which places you should and should not sit. I know growing up when I'd be singing and I'd look out the window, see Brother Ernie, or see someone from church, boy, it always helped. We hurt when others hurt, and we rejoice when others rejoice. That's how it should be. I want you to stand with me. That was a time of invitation. Whatever the Lord's leading you to do, who you need to pray for, this is your opportunity. Come pray with me. Come to the altar. Whatever the Lord leads you to do.